Today is the first lecture in a series on ecology. Ecology asks what influences the abundance and distribution of organisms in space and time. There are several different specialties in ecology. The first is population ecology, which asks how population size of a particular species varies through time. At a broader scale, community ecology looks at relations between interacting species. And an even broader scale is ecosystem ecology, which examines the effects of physical environment on these communities. The last lecture in the series will be on conservation biology, where we'll focus on the human impacts that we're having on natural systems. Population ecology asks what determines the rate of population growth. What limits population size? The most important variable to begin with is called R. It's a letter that stands for the intrinsic growth rate of a population. R is calculated from four different parameters of demography. The birth rates and immigration are given as B and I. Death rate and emigration are given as D and E. Birth and immigration add individuals to a population. Death and emigration reduce the number of individuals in the population. If we know all four of these variables, we can then try to estimate the rates at which populations can grow. As population ecologists, we want to be able to predict population growth. Let's take as the simplest possible example an island. Islands are separated from the mainland. We can restrict it to just those individuals that live there, so there's no migration. We'll say in our hypothetical species, on our hypothetical island, that they live in pairs, and each pair has a litter of two babies each year. And it's a wonderful place to live because no one ever dies. So our birth rate, which we call B, is two babies per two adults. That's one per year per individual in the population. There's no immigration because we're an island. Nobody dies, so D is also equal to zero. And no one can ever leave, so the emigration rate is also zero. If we sum all these up, R is equal simply to one, because it's only being changed by the birth rate. Now, what we want to do is to be able to predict population growth rate from R. And so we want to follow this simple cumulative formula that we have an initial population size of n sub t, and every year there's an increment more determined by the intrinsic growth rate, and that gives us the population size of the next generation, which in this case would be n sub t plus 1. So we have an initial population size of 1,000 on our island. After 1 year, they'll have had another 1,000 babies added to the population, so then it's 2,000 after one generation. At the second generation, it doubles again, so then we're up to 4,000 individuals. Now, an important thing to remember about populations is that they don't grow in a linear manner. We often think about growth as something that is a constant increment each year. And if we did have arithmetic growth, a constant of 2 would give us a straight line on the scale. But populations of organisms follow geometric or exponential growth, so there's a constant doubling time. And so if we have our initial population that doubles every generation, we'll go from 1,000 to 2,000 to 4,000 to 8,000 to 16,000. So after that fourth generation, we're adding 16,000, and it keeps doubling every generation. This is the way real organisms reproduce. They all have the capacity to double because each new individual added to the population can also have offspring. Linear growth is not the way to describe populations. Now let's look at some real data. Here is an island in the Pacific Northwest in Puget Sound called Protection Island in Washington State, where 8 pheasants were added to this island in 1937. And for a while, the population followed this exponential growth. The blue line is the predicted based on the R of pheasants, and the red was the actual observed population size. And so at least for about 3 or 4 years, the population did nearly grow exponentially. But after a while, there was a huge disparity between those two. Now, the reason we get this disconnect between observed and predicted often is because we made a very naive assumption. We've assumed that R will remain constant generation after generation.